Okay, so we're going to document the fact that Jamie had kidney stones, had them removed, and the before and after. So explain to us, Kevin, how he was acting before the kidney stone removal and how he's acting now.
Well, before the kidney stone removal, he was a lot more active. He walks, 8 miles a day, on average 6 to 8 miles a day. Very active, very independent with a lot of things. He was able to get onto the bed with assistance, but they were able to lift his legs up and down. When he sits down, he's able to stand on his own. He'd be there to catch him and want to walk. And slowly, his activity just started decreasing and decreasing. He would sit longer. He didn't want to walk. He couldn't lift his leg over the bed. We would have to lift his leg up for him. And I was like, why is he being so...
We were all confused. What is going on? We didn't even know he had kidney stones.
Yeah, didn't know at all. Didn't know.
Until about a month ago when they discovered it on a CT.
Yeah, a month ago. And we noticed that he was standing on his tippy toes a lot, on his left side, which is also very unusual. And I was like, I don't know why he's walking,
It was the left side that he was standing tippy toe, and then we found out on the CT scan the kidney stones were in the lower left pole of the kidney.
Exactly.
Interesting. So that's how an autistic person could present, is by standing like baseline off behavior. Just be aware.
Increase in his behaviors as well.
Increase in self-abusive behaviors, we saw. Unexplained agitation.
Unexplained, intermittent. Not very smart. His emotions were he was a lot more angry than usual. Frustration, a lot of frustration through his facial grimacing. And it was just hard to figure it out. Sometimes he won't drink or eat, possibly from the pain. And after his surgery, it's completely... just like he was before. He's starting to lift his leg up. He's starting to walk, as much as he was before. He's super happy and gentle. Has a lot of patience, as opposed to before when we would try to be patient with changes or different things. He would get angry easily.
Right, because pain does that. Any one of us would be agitated if you're in constant pain from a kidney stone and couldn't tell anyone.
Yep.
So this is very important for people to know in the medical community. Look, when you have an autistic patient, don't just blame increased off-baseline behavior on their autism.
Yes.
Okay, here you have a situation we can clearly tell you 100% that the kidney stones that were bothering Jamie were definitely causing him a lot of pain.
The doctors were saying, can't be the cause.
Right, they were saying it couldn't because they were non-obstructing, but that is totally false. And there is research to show that non-obstructing kidney stones can, in fact, cause pain in some patients.
And to just pay attention to the non-verbal cues, the little things like that. His tippy toe, why is he walking on his tippy toe on his left side? Well, he's been doing that for, 6 months. And we're like, okay, but why?
Right.
You really have to think, why? Because he doesn't just do that out of nowhere and become a habit.
Right.
You have to understand, use your critical thinking and try to get down to the bottom of it. And then once we figured it all out, put all everything together, it made total sense that it was kidney stones.
Absolutely. And that's what you always need with a patient with autism. You almost even like that show House, doctor.
Yeah.
That's what you need all the time when you're dealing with a nonverbal autistic patient, is to think like that. You have to think outside the box. You have to connect the dots. You can't just blame everything on autism. That is not helping the patient. And you will miss something critical that could be torturing them, like kidney stones, and just keep blaming it, on some other issue.
And especially when you know your patient very, very well. You know exactly, how they are. And when there's something that changes, you really have to pay attention to that because you know them more. And they try to convince you that, it's because they're autistic and that's how they are. When you know that there is a change, you have to stick with your gut and get to the bottom of it.
So what would you advise then for doctors who you were trying to talk to as the home health nurse, and they're downplaying and minimizing what you're telling them? What would you say to them, like how important it is to listen
to honestly listen to what we're telling you and to have some compassion and honestly understand that we do know him, because every time we go in there, they think that he's angry and is always trying to fight and always, when every time we go in there, there's something wrong with him.
Right.
They don't even listen to that. Like, that's hard to...
There's always an underlying medical etiology when
he's
his SIB is exacerbated.
Exactly. And every time they see him, I mean, I understand where they're coming from because that's what they see when we come in. Mm-hmm. But at the same time, that's not what we're, his day-to-day is.
And right.
We tell them that, but they undermine that. They think, oh, well, he's like this all the time.
Because that's the only snapshot they see of him. They don't see him happy and walking around at baseline.
Yeah, they only see one side, and it's not. Like, how could anyone deal with that? We
fight
with them every single day.
Yeah, do they think that he just wakes up every day and hits himself and is miserable? Yeah. That's not the case at all.
So, yeah, just to really listen to what, you know, your clients are telling you and just take the second to critically think, just like we are.
Mm-hmm.
Because when we go to present a case with Jamie to them, we don't just go in there with a thought. This is months or 2 weeks of us critically thinking together as a group, trying to figure out what's wrong.
Mm-hmm.
And then once Jamie is just at the point where he can't, he's so frustrated, he just hits the whole time.
We have to activate 911 and bring him to the hospital.
We go in there and we try to do labs, you know, everything too that they have access to that we don't.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah, we can't do those things. We don't even have IV capability here.
Yep.
So yeah, it's very important. And when we say them, we're talking about, you know, the ER personnel. It's very frustrating. And we're trying, you know, we understand their side. You know, you just see the patient at their worst. But it's also important to listen to people who are dealing with special needs patients who are with them every single day. Don't discount what they're saying and make your own opinion just as a drive-by analysis. Don't just walk in and see some, you know, autistic patient biting himself and screaming and go, well, you know, it's part of the autism. No, it's actually not. It's part of their communication that they're trying to tell you, I'm in pain, help me. I can't talk. I am not, you know, they don't have the same mindset as us. So they're trying to tell us they're in pain somehow. Does that require you to do some extra ordinary things like some CT scans and some x-rays, you know, that, you know, you might not otherwise do? Yeah, do it. Rule things out so you're not leaving a patient in torture.
Anything. They can't present themselves in a way that we can, where we're fortunate enough to tell them, okay, my stomach hurts.
Right.
You know, you can't tell us that.
Exactly.
And it could be much worse than what we think it is, too. So that's another thing. So just always advocate and just really...
And can you imagine if we didn't push to get the kidney stones removed and they wanted us to wait until they just passed? Okay, so he ended up with 6 kidney stones. So can you imagine? Yeah, can you imagine each kidney stone that passed would have been a 911 call to the emergency room and everybody scratching their head going, well, you know, he's just autistic. Let's... Have you contacted psychiatry? It's like nothing to do with psychiatry, okay? Stop it already.
And that's the awful part, because if we would have done that, it would have been just more medication.
Oh my gosh.
Numbing.
Nightmare.
What truly is the reason. You know?
It goes in circles.
Just been in pain and heavily medicated.
Right.
Which is like
useless. Torture. It is torture and medical neglect. That's why you have to get down to the underlying etiology behind. Why is this autistic patient suddenly going crazy, bending over, biting themselves, not walking their normal baseline? Always judge it and compare it on baseline, baseline.
The reason why it was difficult for us to pinpoint it right away is because it was slowly, increasingly getting to the point. And then you would text me and be like, how come he hasn't been walking today? And I'm like, he's happy, but I have no idea. Well, the reason why he's happy is because he's not walking, because the walking causes the pain.
Right.
So
you have to put all that stuff together. Yeah, you can't just be a dull normal when you're dealing with people with autism.
Just relaxing, but he loves to walk. That's what he does.
Yep.
So when you just stop walking, we're pushing him around in the wheelchair. We're like, okay, what's
going on? Yeah, what's going on? It's not normal that he's not walking, which is he normally does 7 miles, 8 miles a day.
Yeah.
That's a huge red flag.
And it's only been, 4 days after the procedure, and he's been walking
nonstop again.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
That just proves to you.
Yep.
That just solidifies what we always knew. You have to medically treat people with autism quickly and efficiently so that they are not being tortured by whatever is not being treated. The underlying undetected illnesses and things like kidney stones or ulcers, I mean, who knows, hemorrhoids. I mean, there's probably thousands of autistic patients out there right now that are not being properly treated, that are running around biting and hitting themselves and having behaviors that people are going, it's just part of autism. No, it's not.
There's something going going on
here. They don't just wake up. They're not just born with autism and then they spend the rest of their lives hitting themselves, okay? It's not Lesh-Nyan syndrome, okay? Mm-hmm. This is autism. You have to treat them, okay? Please listen to people who work with them daily and treat them. Yep. So you will bring them relief and happiness. Mm-hmm. Right, Mr. James? Do we get a smile? He's really...
Yeah, he's out.
He's out. Yep, you want them to be happy.